time. We don't have what we get there. I mean, planning on going. Got your mind made up. You want to go? Praise the Lord. I want to go, don't you? The little boy said he wouldn't raise his hand when the preacher said, who all wants to go to heaven? Everybody in the whole building raised his hand, one little boy. He said, you don't want to go to heaven, son? When you die? He said, oh, yeah. I said, when I die, I'm going to get the load up tonight. I want to go when I die. I'll tell you one thing. Load up tonight wouldn't be bad or shake this world's in. Pitiful. God. The Bible said that they that do know their God will be strong and do extra. Go to the book of Ephesians. I tell you what, let's get the children's church dismissed. And while we sing a chorus of something, it doesn't matter, just whatever. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. Sunday night from Brother Mark and the Lord, and lets us know that God is still on the throne. And when there's a struggle, He's always there. He's always there. Thank you again, Brother Mark. You've done an excellent job. Amen. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, and He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting, that means He gave to the church, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. What a mouthful. He gave some apostles, some prophets, and evangelists, pastors and teachers, for the perfecting. The ministry has a duty and a job and a calling to perfect the saints and to edify the body of Christ. I'm going to try to bring us a simple thought tonight. Single-minded devotion to God. Single-minded devotion. Lord, bless the message in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
You be seated. Go to the book of James with me, if you would. Chapter 1. Joseph, if you would. That's something I added, so I don't have it. And I'm just going to read it off the screen once you get it there. James 1 and verse 5. James is talking. He said, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. All right, go ahead through 8. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. In verse 8, says a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. I'm going to try to preach on that single-minded devotion. A single-minded devotion. When James talked about something unstable, I looked that up and it means unstable. Isn't that deep? That's what it means. It means unstable. Driven and tossed means driven and tossed. It's so simple. And James said that that man should not even think that he would receive anything from God, because a double-minded man is unstable, not just in his spiritual way. In all of his ways, he's unstable. He's double-minded, hit and miss. Here today, gone tomorrow. Up today, down tomorrow. That don't mean people that fight battles and have trials now. I'm not in reference to that, and neither was James. It's somebody that's unstable. Can't depend on them. God can't depend on them. Church can't depend on them. I know some people, you see them come, you see them go. And sometimes you want people to come, of course. But some people you can't take to the bank. Because you don't know where they'll be tomorrow. Unstable people. The work of the ministry in Ephesians 4 that this apostle wrote about is to bring believers into the unity of faith and the acknowledging of the Son of God. That's what this ministry of Ephesians 4 is all about. It is to mature a person who attains to the measure of the full stature of Christ. Christ's likeness in character. That is a man or woman that is single-minded, devoted to God. Single-minded, devoted to God. It's becoming like Christ. That's what Ephesians 4 is telling us. The ministry perfects us. And it works with us, works for us, it perfects us and edifies, and it brings us to the measure of maturity. The ministry is to cause us to become Christ-like. Christ in character, like Christ in our character. You say, well, that'll never happen. I think it will. Yes, sir. I think it will. I think it has to. I've heard people say you can't be perfect, but Matthew 5:48 says you can be. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, you're not going to get perfect here. I'm not implying that. But the scripture from Ephesians 4 bears out that the ministry is to cause us to grow and to mature in our Christ-like character. It causes us to become more mature and growth in our single-minded devotion. The ministry is to reprove and rebuke and exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. The ministry is to teach doctrine. It's to teach for us to become more like Christ, more to mature daily like a child does. A child starts maturing when he's born. One man said, he worked with us, he said his wife had a baby and he missed a day or two, you know, and he'd come on back to work. And I said, well, what do you think of that new baby? He said, oh, I'm going to carry him back. He ain't got no hair and he got no teeth. Okay. But a child starts to mature, and that's the way a child of God has to do. And that's the part of the ministry, to mature people. Jesus invested his entire life in training men, his life here on the earth, in training 3.5 years of ministry. He invested that training men to become disciples, to become his followers, and to be fully devoted to him. Jesus didn't take the back seat to no one. He was very jealous. He devoted himself to these men. A disciple is a learner. It's someone that learns, or pupil, or a follower. And he trained those men, Brother Mark, to train us, to teach us.
Yes, sir. Amen.
And to perfect us. It means to be a disciple is to be a follower or a leader of Jesus.
Yes,
or a leader for Jesus. It means to be fully committed, a disciple.
Yes, sir.
Someone that has gave up everything for the cause of God. John 8:31, then Jesus said unto those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Jesus spent time discipling these men that they could that the word of God through them could train us. The disciple, now here's what I said a while ago. We are to be led, or we are to be able to be taught to get closer to God in our devotion, because Luke 6:40 said, catch this carefully now, the disciple is not above his master. Watch carefully, but everyone that is perfected shall be as his master.
Amen.
Now we're not to be above our master, but we are to strive to be as our master.
Right.
In word and in deed. Rebecca sang the song, can't hardly ever get her to sing. But she got a beautiful singing voice like her dad. Just kidding about that part. She sings a song, I've got a long way to go to be like Jesus. I don't know if you've ever heard her sing that or not. She very rarely sings it. I've never been ridiculed, spit upon, or wounded in my side. Life no bed of roses, but still I'm alive. I've got a long way to go to be like Jesus. But Luke said, we shall be as our master. And that means totally single-minded, devoted to God. Christ was totally single-minded, devoted to the task that was put before him. When he went in the garden that night, the garden of Gethsemane, and prayed, and his sweat became, as it were, great drops of blood. Remember reading that? And he said, Father, let this cup pass from me, but nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That meant he was single-minded, devoted to the will of God, and the call of God, and the work that he came here to do. See, he came to die for our sins. Every day of my life, I thank God, or that is, since I've been in the church, about 45 years, right at it, 44. Every morning, I thank God for Calvary. Had it not been for Calvary, we wouldn't be here today. Totally devoted, single-minded. The goal of a disciple, the goal of a child of God, should be it to become more like Christ. That's what we're trying to do. If we become more like Christ, we'll convert our city. If we could become more like Christ, sinners would just throng this place.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sinners would pack this church out if we become more like Christ.
Amen.
I know it's true.
Yes,
a disciple is to become like his master. What does it mean? You cannot be my disciple. When he said, except you do such and such and so and so. You cannot be my disciple. I said something like, I think it said, hate your father or mother or something. I can't remember exactly how it works it now, but you know what I'm talking about. You know where I'm coming from. You cannot be my disciple. What does that mean? That he's going to forbid you to be his disciple? No, I don't think so. I think, now this is just me now, I think what he's telling us is, if we're not totally committed, we don't even have the ability to make right choices spiritually. If we're not totally, single-minded, devoted to God, I don't think that we have the ability to make a lot of decisions. And so that's what he meant when he said you can't be my disciple, because it's not that you can't be, it's that you won't be. I hope I'm making sense. What does it mean by commitment? When he says you got to make a commitment, it means dying out to yourself and allowing the Lord to take complete charge of yourself. That's what it means for commitment. Totally, singly committed. It is a single-minded devotion. Now watch. Matthew 6:22. I wrestle with this scripture. Almost like wrestling with the enemy. And I think I got it. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, the whole body shall be full of light. If my eye is single, if it's totally devoted to the cause of God, totally devoted, singly minded, then I'm going to be able to follow Him, become more like Him, because it's going to get inside of me.
Yes, it will.
Foolishness will get out of me. Because I could quote you a scripture that says something, all foolishness is sin. Uh-huh. But we don't like to go there because we all like to cut up. So I'm going to leave that one alone, just let you ponder that. But to be single-minded, that just tells me that I just got to be more like my master. If the eye be single, the body's full of life. If I've got myself devoted, totally committed to Him. Did you know the first commandment found from Exodus 20 and verse 3 says, thou shalt have no other God before me. You remember reading that? Did you know that was taking place when God delivered Israelites out of Egypt? And the best I could tell, they worshiped all kinds of gods. They had a God for everything. Like a lot of people's today, they have a devil for everything. The devil made me do it. I had all the jerk come out. It had nothing to do with the devil. It was the jerk. He said, to have no other God, thou shalt have no other God before me. God brought them out of a place, Brother Mark, where they worshiped all different kinds of gods. They were accustomed. They were accustomed to worshiping false gods. Because that's where they were. That's what they were doing. Did you know Abe wasn't Abraham that was raised with a dad that served a pagan god? Wasn't Abraham? And look what happened to Abraham. And so all these, God, I believe God was letting them know that this new nation that I'm making now is going to be different. It's going to be a nation. We're going to take a fresh start. And we're going to be loyal to the God of Israel.
Yes, sir.
Have no other God before me. I think a lot of the problem today is people have just got too many gods with a little g.
Yes, sir.
Got too much in their life. And that's what he meant when he said you can't be my disciple. He wasn't trying to say, I'm not going to let you be my disciple. With all the false gods and all the little bitty gods and stuff in our lives, there's no way we can dedicate ourselves totally to God. And that's why he said the eyes got to be single. God brought them out of Egypt and he lets them know that now that we're going to get loyal to one God, that's the kind of trust and devotion that God has called you and me to.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Why in the world do you think Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, is even in the Bible. There's not but one Lord, one God, who's Father of all, above all, and through all, and in you all. Paul, the apostle, nailed it very plainly. Hallelujah. That's the reason why anyone that calls themselves a disciple of Christ. Now, we're not perfect, but we are to strive to be just like our Master. Just be more like Jesus. I heard years ago a minister on a tape. Well, actually, it wasn't a tape. It was actually, I'll tell you how far back it was. It was a long play album that you play. And I heard him talking about, he was a holy roller preacher, went to the army, and said he'd walk around saying, thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Think of that sort on the base, and said they thought he'd gone crazy. Yeah. They took him to the chaplain or to the doctor, the psychiatrist. And he asked him, said, what makes you act the way you do? He said, what do you mean? He said, well, the guys tell me you walk around all the time hollering, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He said, what makes you act that way? And he said, I thought now's a real good time for me to tell you about Jesus. He began and he said, he told that doctor, said, you think because I don't have to have an eye opener beside of my bed every morning to get me started. You think I don't have to have all, and he names all this kind of stuff, that I'm crazy. He said, but I want to tell you, I think you're crazy. I think you're the one that's crazy. So after that interview, the doctor said, well, I have figured out, I've got it diagnosed, I know what's wrong with you. He said, what? He said, you're a religious nut. He said, but you're not dangerous. Now what? This is true. But you're not dangerous. He said, the only thing, now here's what our disciple will do. Come on. The only thing I'm worried about you is you're going to get somebody else believing what you believe. Right. That's what a disciple is all about. Becoming like your Master. Right. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
A double-minded man can never make right choices. He'll mess up every time. A lack of this commitment. This is the greatest commandment. Now what? Matthew 22:37. Jesus saith unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. Honey, that ain't just in there to fill up a blank spot. That's the word of God. We have to love God tooth and toenail. That means from here to there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And a lack of that commitment, a lack of that kind of commitment, leaves us making wrong decisions.
Yes, it does.
It'll happen every time. It leaves us with wrong values. We create wrong stuff. We love the wrong thing. We get excited too much about the wrong stuff. We get more excited about the Super Bowl than we do a soul. Come on, I'm preaching now. I'm telling you, that is not the life of a disciple. I'm not implying that a person is lost. I'm not implying that. I'm telling you that is not a disciple. A disciple has got their one single-minded devotion to be like their Master. A lack of that, we don't have the right priorities. We don't have the right pursuit. We don't go after the right stuff.
Right. That's good preaching, Pastor.
Well, I would say something, but y'all don't think I'd be personal. Sometimes we care more about our career and our promotions and our bonuses than we do the power of God, or we do the God that's inside of us.
Right.
And the reason is that we're not single-minded. We got too much stuff, other stuff.
Yeah, you're right, Pastor.
Thank you, sweetie. I know. Yes, sir. That's why I love to hear me preach. I always preach the truth. I don't preach no junk. I'm telling you, a disciple is going to strive to be like his master. I read it to you. I read it to you. Boy, that stood out with me, Brother Harry. You say that jumped out on me. When I read that study and that lesson yesterday and today, just jumped out there. And I said, yeah. That's right. That is right. And a lack of that kind of a commitment, it just leaves us with the whole stack of wrong value. A double-minded man, like I said, can never, ever make right choices. A single-minded, devoted commitment causes us to make the right choices and right priorities. To be single-minded, devoted, and committed to God will cause you to do things you used to wouldn't do. You'll get more involved. Brother Pastor Herring told this story. Reverend Kenneth Dyson confirmed it to me standing right back there by that door Saturday afternoon. Brother Dwayne Harry got the Holy Ghost in Juliet, Illinois, and he got to living for God sitting there, and he off at the real cold. They had these old coal oil heaters, Stanley. You probably know what they are, an old coal oil type furnace that runs on coal oil. And some people call it kerosene, comfortable called coal oil. And coal oil good for anything. Brother Henry said he passed the offering pan that night. He lived, him and Joe, his brother. Brother Henry said he had $10. That's all he had to pay that. Yeah. This was on like middle of the week. Yeah. He said he's going to put five in the pan, keep five for himself. Yeah. And said the Lord just moved on and give the whole $10. Uh-huh. So he just threw the $10 in. Yeah. Went home that night, went in the house, the nice warm house, and said he told Joe, said, Joe, I'm so glad you got a little bit of money. He said, because God moved on me to give all the money I had tonight. And he said, Joseph, what'd you say? And he told him again, he said, man, you got to be kidding. He said, the Lord moved on me to do the same thing. So I'm broke as you are. I'm broke too. Brother Henry said they started praying. Got up next morning and went to work. Cold, snow everywhere. Just knew when they got home because the thing was already on empty. I mean, it was out of oil. Got up and come home that afternoon. The heater was still running. Went to bed that night, had prayer, went to bed that night. Went to work next morning, come in that afternoon, and it was still running. All the way to Friday afternoon. Came in from work Friday afternoon with his paycheck, cash, and a can of oil, and said he walked in the door with the furnace cut off. A lot of people say, oh, that's fanaticism. No, that's the power of God. That's what I'm talking about, discipleship. I'm talking about totally devoted to it. When you're totally devoted, you got a single devotion to God, you'll give your last dollar.
Yes, you will. Right. Yes, you will. Yes, you will.
And you'll give your life to it.
Yes, sir.
You'll have the right priorities.
Yes, sir.
A single-minded person is willing to do what a double-minded person will not do. A double-minded person will not give. They'll keep it in their pocket if they're in a tight. They'll give when everything is good, but when things are tough, they won't give. I'm talking the truth now. I'm telling the truth. A single-minded person will do what a double-minded person refuses to do. It's not so much better to be, it's so much better to be single-minded. When you're single-minded, here's what you'll do. When you're single-minded, there'll be no phony baloney. There'll be no mumbo jumbo about your walk with God. You'll stand firm like Daniel did and say lies then or no lies then. I'm a praying. That's what they're doing. You won't be saying But you can do.
All right.
A single-minded person is short on words, but long on deeds. They have character, real character, because they're wanting to live for God. Our prayer should be, Lord, make me real.
Amen.
Not phony.
Come on, come on.
I don't want to be an actor acting out a play.
No.
I want to be real. I want to be born again.
Yes.
Blood bought.
Yes.
Blood washed.
Yes.
Child of God committed.
Uh-huh.
I don't want to sing or preach as if I mean it. I want to mean it.
Yes, sir.
You singers get in this pulpit up here. Number one, you ought to pray before you come up here. But you ought to get up here and sing it and mean it. Don't sing it like you mean it. Brother Mark, you're going to preach, preach and mean it. Don't just preach like you mean it. I want to tell it like it is. I don't want to just tell it like it is. I want to be like it is.
Amen.
I want the truth. I don't just want to tell others how to do it.
Uh-huh.
I want to do it.
Do it.
I don't want to just preach to you.
Uh-huh.
I want to set the example.
Right.
I've always made it a practice of mine because I learned it from an elder. I learned it from an old veteran that we put in his final resting place the other day. Brother Harry would always say, I'll never receive pledges unless I give the first one. And I never have since I've been here. If I take up $1,000 pledges, honey, I'm going to have a $1,000 check or $1,000 worth of $100 bills one in my hand to drop at that offering pan, or I ain't going to ask you to give a
$1,000.
If I only got $200, I'll ask for $200 worth of pledges. I want to do it. I don't want to just talk it. I want to do it. I don't want to have to always be right. I want to be able to admit when I'm wrong. I don't want to be plastic, or I don't want to be a professional. I don't want to be a professional preacher. We got too many of them deadheads running around here now. I don't want to be professional. Hey, what you're seeing right now is what you got, honey. This is it. I'm not anything. I want to be real.
Yes,
I don't want to be plastic. I don't want to be a professional. I want to hurt where you hurt.
All right.
If you got a problem, I want to share that problem.
Amen.
I'm talking about discipleship.
Yes,
I want to mean everything I say.
Yes,
I want to be real. When God sees I'm single-minded, He'll work for me and with me and through me. Just like I talked to God yesterday, day one, I said, Lord, I'm reading that Old Testament about David. And David prayed a simple prayer and said, Lord, shall I go out against my enemy to battle, or shall I forbear?
That's right.
And God spoke. Don't you raise your hand, but I want you to be honest. How many times have you prayed and immediately God's face tells you what to do?
Right.
That's right, me either, Brother Mark. But when we get single-minded, God will work just like He did for David.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Ask yourself the question. Tonight, you asked yourself a question. Am I trying to do the impossible? Many people tonight are trying to do the impossible. That is, am I seeking to serve both Jesus and the world? It's impossible. Because Jesus said, no man can serve two masters. I can't serve God and the world. I can't serve God and love mammon. I can't love my income. I told a friend of mine here just a few months ago, I don't want to pastor a church because it pays me good. That ain't me. I don't want to stay around here because I get a good tithing. I want to know I'm in the will of God.
Amen.
Somebody help me a minute.
Amen.
I'm going to ask, but I'm not going to, I don't want to try to do the impossible. I can't serve God and the love of money. I can't serve God and the world. I can't sit straddle the fence. I'm going to get kicked off that fence. So you asked yourself, Jesus said, no man can serve two masters. James said, let not that man think he can receive anything of God. James 1, 7 and 8, a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. I'm preaching tonight about a single-minded devotion to God. Being single-minded. Sister Christy, right, come to the piano for me, would you, sweetheart? Stand with me if you would. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. As she plays on the music tonight, if you would come around the front, bring any petition that you have to God tonight. If you want to get closer to God, here's your opportunity. Here's your chance. In the name of Jesus. Come on, gather around if you can or if you will. Just talk to Jesus a minute. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God.
do something for the King of Kings. Lord, I pray that I'll stay fully devoted to you.
Praise the Lord. Ain't the Lord wonderful tonight? Praise the Lord. Just got the call, Sister Tambo, that said that Miss Linda passed away. Miss Linda Strickman. So we need to remember that family for the next half of next year on. Keep them in our prayers. If I hear any arrangements, I will let you know. We'll try to let you know by email, by Brother Mark, sending out. Most if you hear and you don't have your if you get text messages on your phone, and if you want to give Brother Mark your number, he'll add you to the list. And he sends out messages from the church on that, and you'll get those messages on your phone. He's got several, but I'm sure there's several he doesn't have. Some people don't want that. That's fine. If you don't want it, that's okay. But if you would like to be involved in that, just give Brother Mark your phone number, and he'll add your number to that list. But I will keep you. We'll try to keep you informed on that. Praise the Lord. All right, remember the last weekend in this month, Brother Joseph Nelson will be ministering for us. We're looking forward to that. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we pray, God, you will touch Miss Linda's family tonight. God, build a hedge about them, Lord Jesus. And God, help them through this time of loss, Lord. God, put your hand upon each one of them, Lord Jesus, and keep them safe. Lord, keep us safe as we go to our homes tonight, Lord, and bring us back Sunday to worship you. Everybody say it in Jesus' name. Amen.